नमस्कार, गुड मॉर्निंग व्यूवर्स एंड आर स्पेशल चिल्ड्रन, बिकॉज यू आर स्पेशल बिकॉज यू आर गेटिंग एजुकेशन थ्रू द ऑनलाइन मोड. वी आर ट्राइंग टू वेरी मच हार्ड टू डिलीवर द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज रिगार्डिंग द एजुकेशन सेक्टर. एंड आई एम राहुल. वी वेलकम यू टू द फर्स्ट सेशन ऑफ टुडेज एंड वी ब्रिंग यू द सेशन ऑफ साइंस क्लास 10. एंड द टॉपिक इज heredity and evolution part 5. Earlier we had 4 parts for this we have already seen. And in the studio we welcome Dr. C.V. Shimre with us with the content, with the subject and with the presentation of the subject. So please welcome ma'am. I'm Rahul and thank you very much for being
thank
with
you.
us. And before we begin, we would like to tell you the numbers, toll free numbers, 1-800-111-265, 1-800-112-199, and our email ID is CIET.KishoreManch@gmail.com. You can watch this live webcast on NCERT's official YouTube channel. So over to you, ma'am. Please welcome and what we would like to see from you today.
Okay. So we have a few things planned today for this session for the next 45 minutes. Before we get into today's session, let me just run you through the previous session, what we did the last time, so that there is some connection with that.
Okay.
So to begin with, let me just run you through the slides that I showed you last time. So can you please take me to the slides?
Yes, yes.
So we discuss a lot about what evolution is. For example, we define what how to define evolution. One way of defining evolution is change in heritable genes. That's what we discuss, and we emphasize on the word heritable, because if it is not a heritable gene, then it's not nothing to do with evolution. Then we also said evolution is change in the allele frequency in a population over time. So that's another way of defining evolution. And we say that evolution happens in population, evolution do not happen in individuals. So when we talk about the term evolution, it's about population, it's not about individual. Then we also define evolution in terms of the magnitude, how big, how huge or how small evolution is happening in the population. For example, if the evolution, the changes that's taking place is within a species, and we call it microevolution, as you can see in the slide. So we also said that microevolution is almost called adaptation, because of these changes, the organisms are able to adapt better to the environment, which could be physical as well as other organisms, predators or other organisms preying on them. And so that's microevolution. So when we say microevolution, it is evolution within the species. That means changes in the allele frequency within the species. So we also use another term, macroevolution. So we define this as evolution that happens at a large scale. For example, evolution of mammals, evolution of birds, evolution of reptiles. So if evolution happens beyond the species level, then we call it as macroevolution. So those are the terms that we use. Then we calculated how allele frequency is calculated in the population, so that we're not going to repeat, but it's important for students to know that allele frequency, changes in the allele frequency is so important, because that's going to lead to evolution, which is initially at the within the species level, and ultimately with changes taking place over and over again over generations and generations, and you come across this macroevolution. So then we also discuss about, so how does this allele frequency change in a population? So there were several reasons, several mechanisms where we discuss. So we discuss, we mentioned several points. For example, mutation was one of those. That means change in the genes, which could be natural, which could be chemical, whatever, environmental. So then we also talked about genetic recombination, which also leads to allele frequency changes. Then we talked about non-random mating, that means selective mating. If organisms in a population start selecting mates based on certain characteristics, then those characteristics, those organisms which do not possess those characteristics, ultimately are not going to survive for long. So that's what discussed. Then we also discussed elaborately about natural selection, then gene flow, then genetic drift. So these were the things that we discussed, and we discussed about, we showed through demonstration or activity how natural selection actually happens in nature. So we tried to demonstrate that through an activity. So then we talked about Darwin a little bit, because Charles Darwin is the person who is responsible for the organic evolution that we're talking about today. So he is also known as the father of organic evolution, as we said. And we discussed about how important his book was on the origin of species by natural selection or preservation of favored race in the struggle for life. So that book changed the whole way people think about evolution, and he got a lot of criticism for that also, but he was prepared to do that. Then something that's very interesting about this book was the sense. So as I said, his book was called On the Origin of Species by Natural Selection or the Preservation of Favored Race in the Struggle for Life. Although this talks about origin of species, Darwin did not really talk about in this book in the origin of species. He was more focused on how evolution takes place in a population and how that happens because of the adaptation value it provides. And so that it was more about evolution that and less about origin of species that book was all about. Then when we talked about natural selection, we gave an example. We took an example of industrial melanism. For example, that's the example that we took. So in natural selection, how does it happen? So if you look in this slide, you can see some of the examples that I have listed down. We discussed last time about industrial melanism, how the color, the population of moth in England changed over time because of industrial revolution. Because of industrial revolution, the environment totally changed. There was a lot of pollution coming out from the industries, because of which the trees, the barks of the trees, and all those changed, the colors changed, the trees became like dark, so this, we can even call it black, you know. And so when the moths which were more popular, the light color moths which were more popular at the time, because of this industrial revolution, because of the changes in the tree colors, bark colors, because of those pollution. So now we find that after years, or in about few decades time, you find that the population of moths were more of dark colored. So that was something that change that was visible within a span of a few decades. So that's something that we always take as an example. Although there are some studies that suggest that it was not the birds that was the selective agent. It was not because the birds were feeding all the time on the light color moth. It was also to do with the strong selection. So there are a few terms which is not very important for students to know at this time, but there is a term called strong selection and weak selection when we talk about evolution. So there are also studies which points out that it is strong selection that was leading to the increase in the population of dark moth. But whatever it is, because of industrial revolution, we found that the population changed from white moth to drastic increase in the number of dark moths in that areas wherever industries were set up. So that was something that was very drastic. Then there are other examples as well, as I showed you there. There are other examples. Darwin's finches is something. So Darwin, during his studies in Galapagos Island, he found that finches had different kinds of beaks depending upon the type of food they were feeding on, or if they were feeding on fruits or nuts or insects. So depending upon that, the bird's beak, this finch's beak were different in shape. Another example is DDT resistant mosquitoes, you know. So we are already familiar with this. We know that mosquitoes are now resistant to DDT. And so that is because of, again, natural selection. Then other examples are resistance of viruses and bacteria to drugs, or the fact that we have different strains of virus, a common cold virus, you know. So these are examples of natural selection that we see happening right in front of our eyes within the span of a few decades or even a few years, you know. So that's what we saw in the last session. So this session, what we're going to do is we are going to focus on other two reasons for changes that is leading to changes in the allele frequency. That is, we're going to focus on genetic drift, and we are going to focus on gene flow. So that's what we're going to do today. So let me just take you to what genetic drift is then. So genetic drift, when we say, last time we mentioned that genetic drift, any change in the allele frequency by chance. Natural selection was not by chance. It was, there was an advantage to that change, because the changes that was happening was advantageous for the population. But in case of genetic drift, there is no as such advantage. Things did not change because it was advantageous. It was by chance. So we say that change in allele frequency by chance, that is a genetic drift, and there is no obvious survival advantage, which is different from the natural selection. Then there are two ways that we look at, we try to demonstrate this as an example about genetic drift. One is founder effect, another is population bottleneck. That's what we normally take examples of when we're discussing genetic drift. So, and this genetic drift, it is more evident in small population, which I'm going to demonstrate in a few seconds now. So let us go to what founder effect is. So when we say founder effect, it is when a few individuals become isolated from a larger population,
okay,
then they form another population, a set of population, right? So there is this huge population, then from that big population, some of those individuals, they move to another population. Another place, so they found,
new place. Yes,
they found a new population there, so they are called founder population. So that's the reason we call it founder effect. So this, the small group may establish new population with a different gene pool. You know, and how does that happen is, for example, if in a population there was some disease that was not very prevalent, but there were some organisms which were carriers of some disease, if that was there in a huge population, so by chance, most of those carriers, those individuals in that population who were carrier of the disease, they happen to be, by chance, they happen to be those people moving away from the population, you know.
Okay.
So in a large population, if there were few individuals which were carrier of disease, and if by chance it so happens that these individuals were mostly who were moving away from the population to found a new population, then what's going to happen is that in the new population, you are going to have more of those individuals with the disease.
Yes.
Just because they, most of them have moved out from that large
right.
population, and now there are high chances for them to produce that disease.
Yes.
Whereas in the larger population, since the population was large and the carriers of the disease were not many, so the chances for the disease to spread was lesser, you know. So because of the founder's effect, what happens is that some diseases becomes very established in smaller populations.
Okay.
So we'll just demonstrate that. So there are some examples, real examples that has happened, which have been seen. For example, the example of retinitis pigmentosa. So there's a disease which ultimately leads to blindness. So
as we call it in general life, we say that is a genetic disease.
Yes, yes,
so
that is a genetic
this
disease.
This is an example of kind of, you know, producing the genetic disease.
Yes, so genetic disease can become very, I mean very evident, you know,
okay,
because of this founder effect. Otherwise, what happens is many of the genetic disease, you will not find that people suffering from that disease just because they are just carriers. And many of the genetic disease happens when they are in homozygous state. That means that both the alleles, both the alternate versions of the alleles have to be of that disease type, you know.
Okay.
And so in many cases in populations, that do not happen. They just happen to be carriers and less of though both the alleles or the they are not homozygous. They do not carry the homozygous alleles. And that is the reason you don't find much of that happening in the real population. But in founders, founder effect, what happens is that since many of those individuals which are carrier of such disease, they move to a population because of which their offspring, chances of their offspring inheriting those alleles from the parents. So if both the parents were carriers, then the offspring is high chances the offspring is going to have the disease.
Okay.
Obviously they'll have the allele, the gene for that disease, but now it will be shown in the individual because now they have both the alleles for the disease. So it is in recessive homozygous state, and so the disease will be seen in the offspring. So that's how, I'll just demonstrate how that happens.
Okay.
So can you please take me to the overhead camera?
Yes, so now we are going to watch some examples.
So we are going
practical.
To yes, we are going to see this, how this founder effect happens and how it's going to impact the population. As
okay.
we said, for example, this is a population of, let's say, some let's just call it beetle or whatever it is. So there's in this population, as you see, there, as I said, there are some carriers, individuals which are carriers of a disease.
Okay.
So this blue ones indicates the carrier of a disease. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the carriers. What's going to happen is, so in founder effect, what happens is, this is a huge population. So some of these individuals, they move to another place.
Okay. From larger area to the small end of town, they
now
found some
they
new
found place. A small population now here at this place.
Okay.
So this, now they have established a new population. Where you can find that? More of this blue color, that means the individuals that is carrying the disease are there in this population. Whereas this is population is huge, but still you find only two individuals carrying the disease.
Okay.
And so the chances of this population exhibiting or showing this disease is not going to be very common. Because in order for the disease to be exhibited in the offspring, you need these two parents. These two parents have to mate. Then only you'll find that this disease will be exhibited or will be shown, will be expressed in the offspring. So since the population is large and this carrier is few, and so chances are that this will mate with this, you know, chances are high that this blue carrier of the individual with the carrier of the disease will mate with normal individuals which are not carriers of the individual,
okay.
I mean the disease. And so the chances of this disease to be expressed in this population is less.
Okay.
Whereas in this case, since the individuals which are carriers of the disease are more, now the chances for this to mate is higher.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
So chances for this, but it's not that they will always mate. These individuals which are carriers of disease will always mate. That's not what it says, but just that individuals were more which were carriers of disease, the chances are that high that they will mate. So instead of this population with huge population, large population, where there is less number of carriers of disease, here there is more carriers of disease. And what you find is that ultimately when this mate, so you'll find that individuals will be offsprings which are produced from the mating of these two individuals will produce offsprings which exhibit the disease. So that happens. And so what happens ultimately is that you'll find that populations with this will be, ultimately you'll find that most of the population in this small population, smaller population will be replaced by this, with the disease individuals. So this is what's going to happen, likely going to happen over time.
Okay.
So this happens because, and this is by chance, nothing, they were not planning that, okay, we are all carriers of disease, now we'll move to another population. That was not the plan. Just by chance that those individuals that moved out from the larger population, they happen to carry, more number of people happen to carry the disease, and because of which, after generation, you find that in that population, the disease becomes very prominent, very evident.
Right.
So that's about founder effect, and so that the whole thing that's happening process, we call it founder effect, the effect of the founder carrying the disease, because of which the disease is now expressed in the new population, new founding population. So that's something that we talk about in a founder effect. And as I said, the larger the population, so if the population that moved away from here was large, you know, then again the chances for them to have this disease exhibited in the offspring is less. So founder effect or any genetic drift, it will be more effective in a smaller population.
Okay.
So this was a small population initially, and so that was the reason that the chances were that it was high. So it was like, since the population was small, so chances for this two to mate was higher than chances for this two to mate. So instead of this two mating, the chances for this to mate with rest of the population was higher. But in this case, the chances for this two carriers of the disease are higher because the population is small and the carrier of the disease is more. It just happens to be more. So that's what we talked about in founder effect. So there is another example, as I said, bottleneck, population bottleneck.
Okay.
So what is this population bottleneck?
Yes.
So there are certain important points again. Sudden change in the environment, for example, flood or fire can cause that, which will drastically reduce the population of those species.
Yes.
Then again, another important point is there will be severe drop in the population. That severe drop in the population size can cause bottleneck effect. We call it bottleneck effect because imagine in a bottle, if there are individuals inside a bottle, I have a diagram for that. Okay. So imagine there's something happening there. So it's very difficult for individuals to run away from the bottle because the neck is small, you know. So it's like only some of those individuals will escape.
Right.
And that is the reason this is called a bottleneck effect.
Okay.
So again, this is by chance alone. You know, this is by chance alone. It's not that this is going to happen and these organisms will run away from those individuals with certain characters will run away from those situations. It's not like, but it's by chance again that some individuals are able to escape from such kind of disaster.
Right.
For example, we said fire or flood.
Right.
So that's what happens. A very interesting example, before I get into, so as I said, before I get into a demonstration, I'll just show you this picture is there in the textbook of NCERT.
Okay.
So if you see the second row, where you see the elephant foot there, you might be able to see that elephant foot in the picture in the second row. So if you see that, I'm trying to demonstrate the same thing here.
Okay.
So what happens? We say that genetic drift happened by chance.
Okay.
So for example, again, can you please take me to the overhead now? So we have this population.
Yes.
So this is a population. So for example, let's say there is now, it's a huge population, it's spread over. So now there is, for example, an elephant, for example, in that slide, as it is given in the textbook, an elephant came, this is a population of beetles, so they're really tiny, although they're a large population, but the size is tiny. And so even the foot of an elephant is huge enough for them to wipe away a good number of their population. For example, now by chance, this is an elephant foot that I'm representing.
Okay.
So an elephant comes in this population, in this beetle population, and now it by chance, it could just stamp on this or this. By chance, let's say it has stamped on this. So now all the beetles that's below this elephant foot. Are now, have now disappeared.
Yes.
I mean, they died.
Yes.
Because the elephant has stamped over it,
yes,
over them. And so now they died. And so this is again by chance, as I said, it is chance purely. The elephant did not choose it. Okay, I'm going to stamp on this individual with blue color beetle.
Okay.
It doesn't say that. But by chance, it just happens so that it stamp over this. And now the whole individuals in this population with blue colored beetle, they are now gone from the population. So by chance, only beetles with green color now remains in that population.
Okay.
And so the gene allele frequency in the population now changes because you don't have allele of blue color beetle anymore.
Yes.
In the surviving population.
We have only green.
Yes, you have only green.
Right.
Beetles now. And that is again, as I said, it is by chance. Because the elephant has stamped its foot on the more of those individuals where the blue color beetle were there. And so now there is no more blue color beetle in this population. You have green color beetle and now you will have more and more of those green color beetle. You know, but at some point, if nature selects or do not select or variation happens and by chance again, some other color, for example, again, may be possible that sometimes over the ages, over the years, over generations, the blue color beetle might appear again.
Yes.
You never know. Yeah, because we say that in a population, because of inheritance, sexual reproduction, variation happens in the offspring. Offsprings are not exactly identical to the parents. There are some changes always happening in the offspring. So, but for now, because the elephant has stamped over the, those individuals which were of blue color, now in this population at least, you have only green color beetle. So again, so initially the population was drastically reduced because of elephant stamping on that population. And so you call that situation a bottleneck effect because the population is drastically reduced.
Yes.
And that was a disaster. For them, the disaster in this situation was elephant foot was a disaster that caused that drastic decrease in the gene frequency. So that's what happens in a bottleneck. So that was an example that was given in the textbook. And maybe we can just go back to the PPT again. So can you take me to the PPT? So in this example, as I said, you can see that PPT, it's very clear. So you have beetles with red color, you have beetles with blue color, elephant happens to stamp on that You know, in this case, it has stamped on the red color beetle, and now because of by chance, it has stamped on the red color, and so by chance, only the blue color remains.
Yes.
And now the population is now of blue color beetle. So
yes.
Again, it's all by chance. First, initially, because of elephant food, the population drastically reduced, the bottleneck effect, that's what we call. Then after that, the population that increase ultimately is of that blue color beetle only. So that's what we talked about. Then another example, another reason for allele frequency change is gene flow.
Yes.
So we have already talked about natural selection, we talked about genetic drift. Now another example is gene flow. So what is this gene flow? So when we say gene flow, it can be either emigration or immigration. Emigration in the sense, if a population, as a set of individuals from a population moves away to another population.
Okay.
So then you call it emigration. We emigrate to different country
new
and
place.
Yeah, new place. And people
okay.
also come to our country.
Place, yeah,
so
okay.
that is immigration. Inward movement is immigration. Outward movement of individuals is emigration, you know.
Okay.
So it can happen. Gene flow, because of gene flow, allele frequency change can happen. So because, again, if I take you to that example again, so certain population with different allele frequency, in a population will have different allele frequency. For example, in that previous example, you had population with green color beetle as well as a population with blue color beetle. So their allele frequencies, there are different alleles for the beetle color. So this can move to different individuals with different allele frequency can move to another population, because of which if the place where they were moving, the population where they were moving did not have a blue color beetle, you know. So this is a population, maybe I should demonstrate again. Can you please take me to the overhead again? In this, see for example, this is a population. Now, a set of population, another population is here in another place. So this is another population, another place, but this is also mostly green color beetles.
Okay,
this
no blue
here,
color beetle.
Here it's a mix of the gene frequencies, like you have green color beetle as well as blue color beetle.
Okay.
Now it so happens that this some of this population emigrate to this population now. So initially this population did not have the blue color beetle,
yes.
but now because of gene flow, now they have this population have alleles for blue color beetle also.
Okay.
And now these things can, the population can change now because mating will happen between this and you can have individuals of blue color more in the subsequent generations, you know. And similarly, when individuals are moving into this, then more and more of those individuals, if they move into this, then chances are high that you'll have increasing number of green beetle population.
Okay.
So this one way the gene allele frequency can change because of gene flow, because individuals with different alleles move to different populations. So
okay.
there is gene flow. And we do this, actually we see this in nature also, I mean, in our daily life. Quarantine is a word that is
yes,
becoming very,
very
popular,
popular
now, but quarantine has been happening, I mean, quarantine of plants and animals. If you go to the airports and seaports, you know, they're very strict.
Yes.
And why are they very strict? Because they don't want genes to flow from one place to another.
Yes.
You don't want some exotic, the genes of some exotic plants or animals from another country
yes.
to come into your country.
Right.
And so, you know, you want to avoid such kind of unwanted gene flow. That is the reason
right.
quarantine is very strict in airports.
You can say now we are living
like
in the era of quarantine.
So we are very,
because of COVID.
Yes. So we now are very familiar with the word quarantine. But again, this also so much to do with gene flow, you know, allele frequency. So that's how we try to prevent the gene flow, especially those which exotic species, you know, exotic species, if they come to another place, what happens is they tend to populate over that place, and we don't want that to happen. And that is the reason that we are very careful with plants and animals or microbes, even, you know, coming in from different countries. And so there are very strict rules in different countries. Some countries are a little bit relaxed, but most of the countries are very strict regarding this. And so they will not allow you to take in even, you know, fruits, apples.
Yes, yes.
They will just let you throw in the airport, and
yes.
they will not let any of those fruits, or even because it might carry some, you know, bacteria, virus, anything,
anything.
Or pests, you
yes.
know, in that. So which could disturb the ecosystem of their country.
Yes.
And this is especially very dangerous when you are taking them to small islands.
Okay.
You know, because small islands are very delicate. They have their own species composition.
Yes.
And if anything new goes in, and if that's going to disturb the ecosystem, then that's going to be really bad for the
yes.
ecosystem. Mm-hmm. And so things are in place. So gene flow is something that we are very careful about, even in our daily life. So
okay.
again, as I said, let me emphasize here by saying that genetic drift is by chance, and there is no survival advantage. You know, all those changes that we showed in the bottleneck effect, or in case of the elephant food stamping on the beetles, there is no survival advantage in that. It just happened. It could be advantageous, it could not be advantageous, but it was by chance it was happening. And this happens more evidently, the chances are high, mostly in a smaller population. If the population was really huge, for example, the elephant food thing, if the population was much, much bigger than the original population, then you might not even see the effect happening there. So it happens more in smaller population than in big population. In big population. So that's what we see in gene flow. And we discuss about all this, how allele frequency changes in a population. But so are those changes in the gene frequency leading to species formation? You know,
okay.
that's a question. So far we have discussed that, okay, because of these things, because of mutation, because of recombination, because of natural selection, because of gene flow, because of genetic drift, allele frequencies are changing, but are these changes leading to formation of new species? So that is the question. Not necessarily it will form to a new species, but it can also give rise to new species. So
yes.
we talk about the word speciation. So what is this speciation? So to define it, how from one species another species evolves, you know. So from one species, how do we get a new species, or how divergence of species happen from a single species?
Okay.
Then another point that is important is in F we have seen, the second point is we have seen that allele frequency can change for various reasons, all those examples that we have given. So after this changes in the allele frequency, if the population individuals in that population for some reason is not able to produce viable offspring after their mating, then you say that new species, they have become new species because they are not able to mate now. So in order to understand that, let us understand what a species is in biology. So how do we define species? So in biological, there are different ways to define species. So, but the most common one is the biological species concept.
Yes.
So in biological species concept, we say that species is defined as those individuals in population which is able to interbreed among them and also produce viable offsprings. You know,
okay.
two words are very important. They should be able to interbreed. But just interbreeding doesn't make them a species. They can interbreed, different species can interbreed, just that they will not produce viable offspring. That means that offsprings which are able to produce another set of offsprings again. So if they are able to interbreed amongst them, and if they are able to produce viable offsprings, then you call that species. And so coming back to speciation. So if they are in at one point, because of all the allele frequency changes that's happening in a population, if at one point these individuals are not able to mate, then we say that they have become different species because they are reproductively isolated now. They cannot reproduce between them now. And so
okay.
we can take it for granted that they have become different species just because they are not able to they are able to mate, but they are not able to produce viable offspring.
Okay.
So reproductive isolation is something that is very important when it comes to speciation. So all changes might happen, but only speciation happens when they are not able to reproduce amongst themselves. So that's something that...
So this is the way speciation
happens.
Means occurs. Happens.
Yes,
okay.
in nature. So, but there are different types of defining what species is, which we'll not get into this at this time. I mean, because that is beyond the level of this class 10. They might study that
yes.
in their graduation level, in
yes.
masters and all that.
Later
you know?
On.
Yes, later on. What is something that is very important, but what is not evolution, you know? So there is this example again in their book, which this one, the third row. Look at the third row. In that third row, the beetles are there, red colored beetles are there. In the second picture, you find that the beetles are becoming very small.
Yes.
the size is becoming small.
Yes.
Because it is just because they did not have enough food to eat. There was scarcity of food because of which their size became small.
Okay.
But that do not mean that they have evolved into a different species. They are the same species, they are same, you know, population in the, in the species in the population. And so, in favorable conditions, again, when food is available, they will feed vigorously on the food that is available. Then ultimately, you find the fourth picture that you can see in the last row. They become normal size
normal
again.
Size.
So, any change that you see need not mean that it is evolution.
Okay.
So it has to be heritable, and these temporary kinds of changes that you see in nature, these are not defining evolution.
Okay.
So there are a few other things that we can discuss about evolution. Maybe we'll try to take up something again. So what do we learn from evolution? So it helps at us in classification. For example, classification based on shared characters. You know, students are aware about nucleus, presence of nucleus or absence of nucleus in organisms. So that's one way we classify organisms. Then there is another, whether organisms are unicellular or multicellular. That's another way you group organisms again. Then whether they are able to function this process of photosynthesis. If they are capable of photosynthesis, then you group them under different category. And whether skeleton is present or skeleton which is which could be exoskeleton or endoskeleton like us, you know. So there are different ways because of the characters that's present in the individuals or in the organisms, based on which you classify them, you group them based on the shared characters. So that's something that it tells us. So the more shared characters two species have, we can say that the more close they are in evolution, in terms of evolution, you know. So it tells us a lot of information about that. So again, how do you trace evolutionary relationships? You know, there are different ways that you can trace evolutionary relationships. For example, one way is that directly you observe some changes that's happening. For example, this have been studied, the beak length or the mouth length of some bucks are different in different places just because they are feeding on different kinds of plants, the host. So that you can see directly now. And evolution of drug-resistant bacteria, DDT-resistant mosquitoes. These are something that you're actually seeing right now, you know. So you can trace evolutionary relationships based on these changes that's happening. Then another very good example is this one. So this is representing artificial selection. So how over the years, over decades, human beings have, selectively cultivated this crop. From the wild cabbage, how many kinds of vegetables have we got? For example, you can see the cauliflower there. You can see the cabbage
broccoli.
There. Yes. All of those varieties that
cabbage.
Came out from a single wild cabbage variety.
Okay.
So we have selected and now we have different species of that, you know.
Okay.
So there's direct evidence of evolution taking place that we are seeing, although this is made by man because we have manipulated, you know,
right.
We have actually manipulated the
yes.
crops for our own advantage because we want to have different diverse forms of plants according to our needs. Somebody wanted, okay, broccoli, I want this variety. So he will try to, you know, he or she will try
but to. Family wise, they are same and the genetically they are connected.
Initially, their evolutionary history, if you look at that, their parent was same. So
okay.
It all started with the wild cabbage. It's because that we chose to have certain characteristics, and so students have studied about in the previous sessions we have discussed about pure breed, you know,
yes.
true breed, we have studied about all those. So
yes.
they can relate those true breed and pure breed with this selection. So we select now, we selectively choose what kind of characters do we want, and so that's what we see in this. And so we see actual evolution happening, although we are doing this by ourselves. So again, there are other examples where you can see, you can trace evolutionary history relationships. Another way is by looking at the homologous organs. So what are these homologous organs? These are, they have, in homologous organs, you have similar basic structure.
Okay.
Similar basic structure. For example, if you look at this, these are the forelimbs
okay.
of different animals. For example, first is the human,
okay.
then the cat, then the whale, then the bat.
Okay.
So if you look at the structure, they have all the basic structure, same basic structure. For example, what are those humerus, you know, radius ulna, carpals, metacarpals and phalanges. So all those features are present in all these four limbs, but they are used for different purposes.
And the shapes are different.
Yes, they are different, but the structure, basic structure are all same, you know.
Okay.
And so when you say homologous organs, they have similar basic structure which are used for different purposes. And so it tells us that, okay, this all these organisms have, you know, their origin somehow their origin could be related.
Yes.
Because they have similar basic structure. And
okay.
So you can trace the evolutionary relationship based on these structures that's present in organisms. Another contrasting feature is of analogous organs. In analogous organs, the origin is totally different, but the purpose is same. For example, you can see this. Wings of birds and wings of butterfly, they are used for the same purpose that is used for flying.
Yes.
But if you look at the structure, the origin, they are totally different. So those are analogous organs. Although analogous organs do not help us in understanding evolutionary relationships, but it can still tell us that, okay, these features are used for different purpose. So
okay.
Evolutionary history, tracing of evolutionary relationships, you can trace using looking at the homologous organs. That's one way. Another way of looking at is fossils. Fossils, what are these fossils? So fossils are the remains or traces of organisms from the past. So it has become so important that paleontology is becoming very popular. Because through these fossils, you are able to understand your past, you know. But again, fossils have their own limitations because you cannot exactly get the sequence of those traces of the past organisms.
But can get some tentative
idea. Yes, they definitely give you some idea. They can even tell you how old those organisms are because there are some kinds of dating going on, carbon dating, radioactive carbon dating. They do, and there are different techniques that they use to measure the age of those traces of the organisms. So you know, fossils also help us a lot in tracing the evolutionary relationships of organisms. So which organisms evolved first based on the age of the traces of the organisms that remains in the fossils.
Mm-hmm.
So this helps us a lot because DNA, you can study some of those. You can actually study some of the relationships using the DNA now, which is used drastically. But DNA cannot tell you everything because DNA, very old fossils do not have DNA in that. And so DNA will not give you sufficient information. So fossils, you come back to fossils. And so the more you get fossils, which gives you the sequence of, you know, organisms that evolve over time, then the better you can draw your
DNA.
Yes, you can get more details from fossils.
Okay.
So in the sense that for the past, I'm talking.
Yes.
Because DNA do not, for DNA, you have to have some DNA which should be, you should be able to extract from the remains.
Yes.
But all very old fossils will not have those DNA in that.
Okay.
So that is the reason DNA has their own limitations. But fossils, since you can study the age by radioactive dating, so you can see how old that fossil is, you know, how old that organism had survived. So that's how fossils help us a lot in evolutionary setting, understanding the evolutionary relationships. So those are some ways, you know, that you can trace evolutionary relationships. Like, yeah, maybe we can continue a few topics more of this chapter, and we can take one more session next time and wind up the whole chapter of heredity and evolution, I guess.
Yes,
yeah.
Definitely, ma'am. This is really interesting for us as this is the part 5 of heredity and evolution, and we really thankful to you that you came here and took some time in your busy schedule, and we have seen the wonderful session. Thank you very much for joining with us.
Thank you.
So this is the session of science class 10th and the topic was heredity and evolution part 5. So please don't go away. Stay with us. We will be right back with the next session. That's all for this session. Namaskar.